Hey everybody, welcome to Wood Chat for August 7th, 2013. I'm Matt Gravall from Uppercut Woodworks. You can find me on the web at uppercutwoodworks.com and on Twitter at Uppercut Wood. If you are in the text chat and want to watch the video,
did we lose Matt? Awesome. In the middle of the introduction.
It was
unmute
so
yourself, Matt.
Yeah. Sorry that
it there you go.
Anyway.
Oh boy.
Yeah, we're starting Wood Chat. Hey everybody. If you're over on the if you want to watch the video and the text chat at the same time, go to uppercutwoodworks.com/woodchat/chatroom. If you haven't refreshed that page in the last 10 seconds, go do that, because we just updated the video and to get our special guest in. So, hey, Chris, how are you? Why don't you do your introduction while I fix all this stuff?
All right, Matt. I'm Chris Wong here from Flair Woodworks. You can follow my blog at flairwoodworks.com/blog and follow me on Twitter at Flair Woodworks. Now, we also have Scott Meek with us today, as usual. How are you doing, Scott?
Hey, Chris. I'm Scott Meek. You can find me at scottmeekwoodworks.com and smeekwoodworks on the Twitters. And then our special guest today is Mr. Jay Bates.
Yes.
Hey, guys.
So, Jay is our latest participant in the Telephone Game Design Challenge experiment. And
where can I find you, Jay?
I've got a website, jayscustomcreations.com, and all over the social networks, and there's too many to name, so if you just go to the website, they're all at the top. You can click on them.
And on Twitter?
Yeah, Twitter at jbates86.
jbates86.
Yes.
All right. So let's have a look at your design here, and you can walk us through it. Now, Jay, I really like what he did. He did his design in SketchUp, and he created a video where he shows all the steps he did to transform Brian Van Wiede's design into his own. Now, it's a 13-minute video. Was that real time, Jay?
Yeah, that was real time.
That was fun to watch. I'm going to drop a link into the Twitter chat a little bit later, and our viewers can watch that. I would definitely recommend it. It was a lot of fun. Not being a SketchUp user myself, to watch Jay maneuver and manipulate the design to make it his own.
Thanks.
So, let me...
Props to you, Jay, by the way. You got Brian's design figured out into SketchUp. I gave up on it because I was having trouble on the legs. So.
Yeah, it's curves and SketchUp aren't the easiest thing to get along.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Especially when you have compound curves going into each other.
I told Chris that he has to email me the SketchUp file because I'm going to pick it apart and figure out how you did it.
I've got the original SketchUp file that I did not modify as well of Brian's design.
Yeah, that's what I'd like to see. Sure,
so. Okay. Now, that's kind of reassuring to me because I don't use SketchUp, and I've kind of avoided it just being something kind of unfamiliar to me. And knowing that it isn't so good with compound curves, I feel a little bit better about ignoring it. Seeing as compound
curves. It is, but it isn't. There's just
you have to know how
steps
to do it.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
I just haven't learned enough of it.
So I'm going to share some pictures of Jay's design, and of course, you can see all the past designs at on my site at flywoodworks.com/telephone game. There's a menu item for that. And you should see the table here now. And Jay, you can tell us about what brought you to this design.
Well, first thing as far as changing Brian's is I personally don't have a bandsaw, so me and curves do not get along good at all. And I really like straight, bold lines. So I went back to just basically tapering the legs, just give it to something to look at. And the top, I like the horseshoe top, or the wraparound top, whatever you want to call it. Got rid of the curves again. And then the second layer, the actual shelf itself, I wanted that to go all the way around with the same perimeter as the top. give it a little bit more functionality. That way, the way I saw this was at first I wanted to change it into like a computer desk, but I guess it'd be more of a writing desk than anything now. I wanted to take it a little bit further and add some type of flat panel computer screen mount, but then you get into the problem with if it's a computer thing, then where do you hide the wires? Where do you put the tower? So I just ditched that idea.
Well, one thing I see with the spindles you have there, it allows you to probably drop a cord through there instead of having it go over top of the desk, which would be nice to have.
Right.
You could probably hollow out a leg, too, if you wanted, right?
If you're that ambitious, yes.
Yeah. All about customization.
Yeah. But that's pretty much it. I mean, just getting back to the straight lines, and most of the joinery, the top horseshoe is a 6-inch square half lap. I think that'll give it a lot of strength as far as the inside perimeter of the top shelf, as far as it wanting to bow down from weight.
Yeah.
It'll strengthen out from that back piece, and then the stretchers along the bottom are all half lapped in there.
And when you watch Jade's video, you get to see how he created those half laps, which was kind of it's fun for me to watch.
Thanks.
I know someone's going to ask it, so I'll ask it right now. How would you attach the legs to the top?
I didn't want to say that in the SketchUp video. I personally, I'm an easy guy, so I would go pocket holes, and most people kind of frown down on pocket holes, so I just didn't put it in there.
You can't see me right now, but I'm frowning.
Yeah, exactly. There you go.
This has to be all hand-cut joinery, dang it.
Yeah.
Didn't we make that a rule? That's good.
No, we said table cat was the only rule.
Anything goes. Yeah. I guess a few alternatives would be a dado across the legs to seat the top and the shelf into.
Yeah, I did that on a fairly similar design I did a couple weeks ago, actually been about a month ago, a pocket hole sofa table, and I cut a little dado, mortise, whatever you want to call it, into the legs, and I put the bottom shelf in there, and glue would have been fine just like that, but I reinforced it with pocket holes. So.
And then another method, you could just drive a screw right through the leg and then cap it with a contrasting plug.
That would look really good.
Or you can use dowels on the inside. Lots of options for sure.
L brackets,
yes, yeah. Absolutely. So, looking at the top corner, yeah, you're looking at the 6-inch overhang from the leg to where the inside of this ledge terminates. So, Jay was talking about how that half lap, that big wide 6-inch half lap, provides lots of stability for that end there. If you put weight there, it'll all be held up by that joint, no problem at all.
Hopefully.
I don't see any possible issue with that at all. I don't think it's hopefully. I think that's a really solid joint.
The weakest point on that upper top is those corners.
Right, the front corners?
The front
or the top legs.
What's that?
Where the corners where the legs are.
Yeah, opposite there. If you were to,
the
most leverage you could get is if you push down on that corner.
Yeah.
Right. That'd be the weakest. That'd be the weakest place.
Mm-hmm. Well, hopefully, if someone was to use this thing, all your action would be on the middle shelf or the actual shelf itself where you're working on. You know, picture frames and all that other junk you have to have on your desk up on top.
Yeah.
I think that would support 40 pounds easy right in that corner there. Especially if the long grain runs the length of the piece.
Yes.
I guess that would also be dependent on the strength of the joinery used between the leg and this this piece, whatever we're calling it here. Arm.
So here's a question for you guys. What type of wood would you guys use on something like this?
I like the contrast you have here, so I would go with contrasting woods for the spindles and the main components. I'm not sure if I'd also use a contrasting wood for the stretchers down below or not.
I can see it in a quarter sawn oak.
White oak?
So you can get the Ray Flex. White oak, yep.
White oak, yeah. I like white oak with, and then maybe do the spindles and the walnut.
Or wangy.
Yeah. But I love walnut. I could see myself doing the whole thing in walnut.
I love walnut, too. Yeah. Walnut's my favorite wood.
Yeah, I mean, it's just easy to work. Smells wonderful. Mm-hmm. So, those spindles are square, right? They're not round?
Correct, yeah. They are square. And I guess you could draw, you could do a little mortise for each square spindle, but I didn't put them in the SketchUp design. It just takes too much time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'd probably do a channel and then do little spacers in between them.
Yeah, fill them in. Yeah, I've done that before. That works all right.
It'd certainly be the quickest way.
Yeah.
Save a lot of time.
And also because it's, because it's a fairly short spindle, and because of that large overhang, you won't, those spacers will be fairly well hidden.
And the space, the channel, like you said, actually would probably be by far the best option, because if you got that many mortises to line up during glue up, that would be a nightmare.
Just a bit.
Yeah.
At the very least, you could do the channel on the bottom of the upper, the top piece.
Yeah.
And then just more of this bottom, and then it would kind of give you a little bit of a leeway there.
Yeah.
For glue up.
Yeah. I have done that channel design before with the bed frame that I did, and it probably had maybe 20 to 26 slats in it, and that was a pretty stressful glue-up to get them in top and bottom. And to get 26 times 2 little spaces in there as well. So I'm not jumping to go back to that design, the groove and the spacer. I think dowels would might be my choice, or if they're taking no weight, no stress at all, just glue them in.
Well, or did you say don't glue them in?
Just glue them in. No dowels. No interlock.
Yeah. Oh, so just a butt joint, basically.
Yeah.
Between the top and
reinforce it with some headless pins.
That'd be a good option, yeah. From the bottom, or the top, maybe.
Yeah, I was gonna say if they're not structural, maybe not even glue them. As long as they won't spin, who cares?
Just float. Oh, okay. Yeah. You could cut your mortises or your groove and just float them. Yep.
And they're not gonna come out, and if they're not gonna spin, if they're not structural, mm-hmm. who cares?
Yeah.
Just less glue squeeze out to clean up.
Mm-hmm. I guess alternatively, you could mortise them right through the bottom and then slide them in from the bottom so you don't see it at the top, and then just add a bead of glue.
Or you could, kind of like a fence panel, you can buy a pre-assembled fence panel, just make the entire assembly with some small trim to connect them all top and bottom, and then set the whole thing in there.
Yeah,
that's a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can make them round and drill holes.
That would probably be the easiest.
Or you could turn each one.
Or,
round off the ends.
Or like the cross pin for Scott's Planes, you could start with the square and use a plug cutter to cut a round 10 on each end.
Yeah.
Yep.
Sounds like a lot of labor.
Yeah. How about
for the simplest thing for me?
I would panel tack to the end.
I would make it out of OSB and just spray paint it black.
Hey, how about a panel?
But a pink foam.
Yeah, we talked about like a metal panel inside a groove in a past show.
Yeah,
something like that would look good here, I think.
Oh, instead of the spindles, do something like that.
Yeah,
that would be.
And
cool.
It'd be just one piece to align with the four grooves.
Yeah, that would add a really unique modern take on it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And depending on the metal panel, you could make this. You could, depending on the metal panel, you could give this thing a much different vibe. If you use like a chrome diamond plate, right, it'd be very monster garage. But you could also use copper, and copper would give it an older feel, like almost a mission or a prairie feel.
Yeah, copper with walnut or the white oak either would look pretty sweet.
Mm. Yeah. You could even do glass. Wow. You could get some cool pieces of glass in there.
Stained glass?
Doesn't even have glass. Stained, just old, cool architectural glass would look awesome.
Yeah.
So, Jay, before we started, I said, hey, Jay took out the curves, and Chris said, yeah, Jay doesn't like curves.
The only thing I have to cut curves is a $20 El Cheapo jigsaw that doesn't really get along well with me, so.
Gotcha.
I think I've used it, I think I've only got one project that I've actually ever put curves in, and that's just the bottom arch on a blanket chest. Other than that, it's just straight lines and easy stuff.
So your tapers, people would say you went upside down with your legs.
I like that look, and honestly, if I was to make that, I would make the outside edge on the tapers, the long grain, so that the inside two set faces are the actual end grain of the taper. Mm-hmm. If that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So that way, you know, basically your top and bottom would have a compound cut on them, but that way you don't have any end grain coming up the leg. Because all your tapers are on the outside.
Okay, sure.
The inside two faces are vertical.
Okay, that's good.
Oh, gotcha. Point. Okay.
Yeah, you can see that in this picture here. Didn't really show this, but from this parallel perspective, the inside faces of the legs are
outsides. Okay.
Right up. Yeah.
Okay.
And that makes your joinery easier. Your half laps. With a stretcher.
That's right. That's mainly the reason why I did it, is so that your half laps would be on a perfect vertical surface.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. When I've done tapered legs in the past, usually, well, I guess for the stretchers it can't be avoided, but at the top end, I'll start the taper at just below that tabletop.
Mm-hmm.
And bring it down, and it's usually not noticeable.
So you'd have it straight up until the bottom of the... In the top section, you'd have straight, and then you'd start the taper, Chris?
I think so. Yeah. If I were to do the taper...
It makes the joinery easier.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I did on the pocket hole sofa table I did a couple months ago, is the taper started after the bottom of the physical table itself.
It makes the joinery easier for the top shelf, but the middle shelf... If you're rabbiting it, you could cut the rabbits before you tapered it.
Yeah.
You could do that.
Yeah, that's what I did on my table.
Sure.
But you could do rabbits for that top shelf, too.
Mm-hmm.
And cut all the rabbits before you cut the tapers.
Yeah.
That would work. Jay, what wood were you thinking of for this?
I'm cheap. That'd be pine.
Yeah. Yeah.
That'd be construction grade 2x4s.
Now, what size are the legs? Are they 4x4 at the bottom?
They are 1.5 inches at the top, 1.5 inches square, and then the bottoms were 3 inches, I think.
Okay.
So you'd get some 4x4s and cut them up.
I would actually do a lamination first. First off, just simply because locally, I don't know where. I don't know what the deal is locally, but I can't find hardly any wood. You've got to drive over to Birmingham, which is a couple hours east of me, or I'm in central Mississippi, so it's just, I don't know what the deal is, but you can't find any hardwoods at all, barely.
Really?
Yeah, and then 4x4s, the only 4x4s you can get are treated.
So you can't go out and buy a fir or pine 4x4?
You can just snag some coming down the river?
That is correct. Maybe.
So we've got some interesting suggestions from the chat room about materials and different, walnut was the popular choice. I think everyone agreed that walnut would look good, and not surprisingly, a contrasting wood of maple, eastern maple, came up as well. But one that I like from Chad Gorshing is to put some holly in there.
Mm-hmm.
And another of his suggestions was to inlay the top deck, the upper deck we're calling it, with some green inlays or any kind of inlays, really.
All that is way over my skill level.
Yeah. Even a bit of stringing, if you ran a saw cut along the inside edge and sunk in a piece of, I don't know, ollie or something. Something for it. It's a really nice, simple design, and it can be enhanced in many different ways.
Thanks.
Or it can be left as own, too. It stands on its own as well.
What other options?
I'm really. Oh, good.
You go ahead, Scott.
I'm just really glad to see a big change in the design and the start of a different direction. I think that's going to take. I'm really excited to see where it goes again. I think I think the really curvy thing kind of played itself out a little bit. There was really not any farther we could go after Brian's. It's interesting to see it take a different direction. I'm excited to see what happens next again. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's good to hear. I was afraid I changed it too much. So.
Well, if you're splitting hairs, there is more than three changes, but you know, we don't.
Yeah.
If you guys don't remember,
you couldn't really like you couldn't really not you know with the direction you're going. So.
Yeah. If you guys don't remember, this is Brian's design here. He had the separate level top and bottom, each anchored to the base and not connected otherwise. And of course, we rolled through designs going back to Diami's, his kind of molded one piece, everything flows together design. And before that, we had Megan Fitzpatrick's design and Greg Palmer's. And I think Scott was, he probably put the biggest changes into it up until now and kind of set it in the path where it headed. I guess everyone does that, but Vic's and Matt's design and mine at the very start being fairly blocky and angular.
It's almost a little bit back to its roots, Chris.
It is. I've said it before and I'll say it again. I'm surprised that it went to curves as quickly as it did.
Yeah, it seems like Jay's design should be an intermediary between like yours and Matt's, or Matt's and Nick's.
Mine and the next one, yeah.
Yeah. It would fit in well in between the two.
It's pretty cool, though. Jay, what other options did you consider besides the spindles for that space?
Honestly, I really didn't. I just thought of something to stop my papers from sliding if I was using it. Just something, but yeah, still where you can look through it.
Yeah, there's a functional requirement there. A lot of the designs, that was actually a problem where things would fall. Like last week, right. We'd have things that would fall. On Diami's, you wouldn't. On Megan's, you wouldn't. On Greg's, you wouldn't. On Scott's, you wouldn't. On Vic's, you wouldn't. I guess it's really Brian's. You'd really have the biggest problem of things falling onto the floor. The spill ramp is gone too.
Yes, so sad.
Now, if you were to spill, it would go down to the lower shelf and out the spindles.
And it would sit there. Yeah.
I'm just trying to figure out what kind of floor, slanted floor, you guys are working on where your papers are just sliding off your desk randomly.
That's a good question.
I could show you what my current desk looks like and how messy and how I stack things on the floor around me if you wanted to.
So one thing I see in Jay's design that we haven't seen before. With that split level, one on top of the other, and you've got some inside corners which can hide stuff for better or for worse, right?
Most of the time for worse.
Yeah, I'm kind of thinking that. Like, you can hide something you don't want to see in the back corner, or you can lose your pens in the back corner, which is what I would do.
Yeah. Maybe pull a cell phone charger cable through the back and slide your phone off to one side.
That's great, yeah. And then you can let the cable slide back, and it's hidden out of sight until you need it again.
So, Jay, you're saying it's hard to find wood. I've been asking some of the guys in the chat room, have you tried some of the online places?
I looked on online until you see the price, and again, I'm a cheapskate. There's no way that I'm going to pay that type of money for wood that I haven't physically touched or seen.
Yeah. What about reclaimed stuff? Like, there's been a lot of guys over on Woodworking for Mere Mortals building stuff out of pallets.
Yeah, I have an entire section on my website called Trash to Treasure. I'm maintenance at an apartment complex, so people leave crap behind all the time, and I like to. I've dismantled 3 or 4 sofas and used the hardwoods out of that. Some really nice walnut out of a sofa, by the way, and just all kinds of fun little goodies that people throw away that you really wouldn't otherwise think that there's nice wood in there. You know, reclaiming hardwoods out of that, and then I took an old one of those particle board imports, small little entertainment centers with 2 doors on it and 2 glass doors, and routed a little router plate hole and turned it into a router table. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of good stuff around us. You just got to open your eyes for it.
Yeah.
And it's not just pallets either.
I didn't think of taking apart couches and other stuff like that.
It's like a lot of work.
A lot of staples.
A lot of staples in it.
Yeah.
Yes.
You ever burn a couch?
It's more of a, you know.
That's a fire.
Yeah, that's a big fire. I have done that. It's more of a, you know, pat yourself on the back. You did a good thing. It's a lot of nail pulling and a lot of staple pulling. Physically getting the wood off of the actual structure is a pain in the butt, too. But I think it's worth it in the long run.
Yeah. Did you find walnut inside a sofa?
Yes, I found walnut inside a sofa. I turned, I turned the walnut and I found a bunch of maple and a headboard. So I took those two together and made some really nice maple and walnut salt and pepper shakers.
Nice.
But that's the extent of my hardwood experience is finding crap.
Hey, I want to make a quick comment about the searching and buying online, because I end up having to buy a lot of my stuff online just for, you know, what I'm looking for is, you know, I like to get a lot of thicker stock, and so sometimes online is the only option I've got. There's a few of them that have gained a reputation for really being good on that. I know you mentioned not being able to touch the piece that you're buying.
Mm-hmm.
That was kind of my concern at first, too. But places like Cook Hardwoods, Griffin Exotic Woods, Tropical Exotic Hardwoods out in California, there's some of those places that have started to gain a reputation for their online sales. If you call and actually talk to them and say, if you've got a project where you need a specific piece, and you say, hey, this is what I've got, you know, and really give them every detail that you possibly can. why is Chris's thing?
Just laughing.
It's, if you give them all the details, they'll really search out the right piece for you. So. Another good one is Shannon Rogers' venture that he started with McIlvaine. Hardwood to Go. He's got a lot of stuff that's not necessarily the really exotics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's more the extra pieces that need to be sold in smaller quantities. So. You're going to get more reasonable prices there. A lot of the places, like Kern Hardwoods and places like that, you're paying for really special, unique woods. That's why they're so pricey.
Yeah.
So, just throwing it out there.
Yeah, so because I've heard of CR Lumber, and I've heard of Bell, and I've heard of...
Bell's good.
And I've heard of Hardwood to Go, and I know that Mark Spagnolo, Bell does these project packs for him.
Yeah. Yeah, the guys at Bell will really... They'll really do the hard work. And they are woodworkers, so they know what you're looking for if you tell them what kind of project you're doing. So,
what are the shipping costs usually like? Is that, I mean, because I think that would probably be pretty prohibitive, wouldn't it?
If it's something that you can't, like with Bell, if you can get some nice curly maple, They're in northern Michigan, so they're in the land of maple. So you can get some really nice stuff. So it might be worth a few extra dollars for the shipping if you're looking for something you need.
Yeah.
I've also bought wood on eBay before, which is a much bigger crapshoot because you're just trusting that the pictures that they posted are correct. And, you know, whereas the guys like Bell, you know, they're staking their reputation on it. So, you know, a bad review for the guys at Bell is going to be really bad for them in general, for the business. Whereas the guy on eBay, if he screws you over, no one's going to care.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah. Now, another option for wood, the one that I go down, that I pursue, is getting, sourcing my own lumber, getting the trees custom milled. Now, unless you live in the desert, I would think that's an option for anybody.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a direction I'm going to start going with the woods for my clients. So.
Mm-hmm. Jay, have you ever considered custom milling lumber? Are there you don't have a bandsaw, but I guess having it milled for you?
Not really. I live in a concrete jungle. I'm in the middle of the city, and there's really nothing local that I can source that to.
Hmm. Gee, I think I am pretty fortunate about where I live here in relation to wood suppliers and tool suppliers. I've got it pretty good.
Okay. I've got Lowe's. That's about it.
Gotcha. What about other cabinet shops in your area that are building cabinets that you could hook up with?
I haven't really pursued that route, actually. Honestly, mainly because most of the stuff I build is just small crap for my home. I don't really... lately, I haven't had the time to commission anything.
Yeah.
And even so, it's just most of the stuff I work with is dimensional lumber, picnic tables, benches, stuff like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
The market here for higher end stuff. Well, first off, I live in the poorest state of the country, so not that many people want to buy custom stuff. And if people do have the money to buy custom stuff, they're not coming to me.
So you're really in it just for your own personal enjoyment.
Yeah. Yeah, it's more of a hobby than anything.
That's cool.
It's a hobby that tends to pay sometimes, so.
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice when it can do that. Okay. Does anybody else in the chat room have any questions for Jay?
Video, Chris?
Or
let people watch that on their own.
I think it's better with the audio, and I don't think we can play the audio in the hangout. So I would suggest people just watch it after the show. It's a 13-minute video. Yeah. Really engaging video. I'd definitely recommend it, even if you don't use SketchUp. It's fun to watch.
Jay, your trash to treasure section is pretty cool.
Thanks.
High yield pallet dismantling.
I did a lot of YouTube stuff back when I had... just a cell phone for a camera, mm-hmm. and a crappy cell phone at that. So the majority of my previous videos, really crappy video quality. So I apologize if you want to sit through them rather.
It's fine.
Hey, one other thing I was going to say, apparently I dropped signal for a little bit there. Being in a city, check out like Urban Lumber. Do a search for urban lumber in your town, in your city, and see if that's an option. Because there are companies now that are getting into that, where if there's a storm or something and knocks down trees or whatever, they'll harvest the urban stuff and mill it and everything. So that might be an option even in the city. So, or if there is a storm and you see some neighborhood trees, you know. Be the first one there to say, "Hey, can I have a tree?"
Yeah.
There's been a bad storm every day for the past like 5 or 6 days here, so should be right around the corner.
Do you use a metal detector on this stuff?
No, I use cheap blades on my pallet dismantling.
You're a very practical person. I like it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm just some dude with a camera. I'm just everybody else, you know. But for palettes, the only pieces that I'm interested in are the slats. So I just use a reciprocating saw and just cut the nails in between the wood. The structural members of the palette are pretty much useless unless you're just going to make a cross cut for length, because the nails are still in there. But other than that, you know, I'm just going to use a cheap blade on the circular saw, or if I'm cutting up crappy lumber like that, I'll switch over to a bad blade or the blade that actually came with my table saw to run them through.
Yeah, that's a practical way to go. There's a flooring company, I think they do flooring, they do reclaimed flooring, and they're running through boards which have nails in them, and they just do this all day, every day. And all they do is they put on their Freud blade, they cut for the day, take off the blade, put a new blade on the next day. So they go through a blade a day, and it cuts for them, and it lasts the day, so they just recycle it afterwards. They don't even sharpen it.
Where is this?
This is not far from where I live.
They just go through Freud blades like they're
supposed
to.
Yeah.
All right.
I was talking about that, but I said they don't sharpen them. Maybe they lose teeth as well, and
They've got to be losing teeth.
Different world.
Maybe it's the low end Freud. I keep thinking of the super nice end.
Oh, there's
Freud's
a $40 Freud.
Yeah.
And if they're just tearing stuff up, then that's gonna be definitely fine. So.
Yeah, and they put all kinds of new technology, new kinds of carbides. I was trying a jigsaw. No, a reciprocating saw blade, and carbide tipped, and they had the sample, a 2x4 with a nail through it. They said, cut through this, so I cut through it, and I didn't feel the nail. I thought it would have slowed down and kind of sat there for a second or two before cutting through, but it went right through like the wood.
Carbide tip reciprocating saw blade, that sounds expensive.
Well, they're obviously more, but their justification is that it lasts longer and it cuts more quickly.
Right.
By the way, since we're talking about blades and carbide tips and everything, we talked previously about my new bandsaw and I was getting a blade and we discussed that on here, but I think I mentioned to you on Twitter, Chris, but I did go ahead and get the Laguna Resaw King.
Oh, yeah.
It's freaking awesome.
Yeah.
It is, isn't it?
Oh. I just,
look
yeah.
at your face, dude. You're
I love
so
it.
Happy with that blade.
I love it. Here's why. I can resaw my planes, and I only have to take a few swipes with the plane to clean them up. With my other bandsaw, with even the best blade I could put on that, that I could afford to put on that one, I couldn't do that. It was terrible. And now it's like butter, so...
Did you have a carbide blade before?
No, it was my first carbide.
Okay, yeah.
Did you ever find out if that Lennox blade and the Laguna are the same thing?
I don't believe they are, because I was looking at, I think Lagunas are made in Europe somewhere. And the Lennox are made in the U.S.
Gotcha.
I believe. I could be wrong on that, but I know they're made in different places, so. And they're different teeth configuration, too, so.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the Laguna has a variable pattern.
Yeah. I can definitely see the benefit of it, so. I think it would be even sweeter if there's a little bit of a shake or vibration in the saw that I can't find where it's coming from. At some point, I'll have to check the pulley and see if that's out of whack, but. I'm getting good enough cuts with it the way it is. But I'm sure if I could figure that out, it'd be dang near table saw quality. So,
would you try a link belt?
No, that's a good idea. I didn't even think about that because it's a V belt. So yeah, a link belt would work for that, wouldn't it? I'll give that a try.
So,
did you check your tires?
So Jay, we talked to.
Yeah, I checked. They'll need to be replaced sometime in the next year or so, but.
So Jay, we've talked about your attraction to straight lines. Do you have any interest in getting a jigsaw or a bandsaw that'll cut some curves and some different material?
Yeah, I definitely want a bandsaw. I'm really been thinking about just buying a $400 or $500 bandsaw, something that'll just cut curves, just to get something, just to get some variety to it. But as of right now, I just haven't pulled the trigger. I probably already would have if it wasn't busy season at work. I'm working too many hours right now. I haven't been in the shop in like 3 or 4 weeks now.
Mm-hmm. Watch Craigslist.
So.
Yeah, you can do a lot with a 14-inch bandsaw.
Yeah.
Craigslist in my area is like... Craigslist, it's weird too, because the tool section, you'll see a 15-year-old Delta miter saw for $200. You know, it's exactly, okay. it's ridiculous.
That's a lot of money for an old saw.
Everything on Craigslist in my area is a lot of money. Mm. Anything tool-wise, anyway.
Yeah. You have a Home Depot around you?
I don't. I've got a Lowe's a Lowe's right up the road and a Home Depot, I think. It's an hour north of me, Home Depot.
Okay.
How far away from Springfield, Missouri are you?
From where?
Springfield, Missouri.
Shoot, I imagine that's probably about a 10 or 12 hour drive.
Okay.
Maybe a 10 hour drive.
Grizzly does these
warehouse
sales, and you can go up there and get stuff that's scratched or dented. Their lowest price bandsaw, and I have one, and it's won awards, I mean, as a best value and stuff like that, is, I think, $425. And so if you were to go up there and get a scratched one, you wouldn't pay shipping, and you'd probably save a bunch of money.
Yeah. It's a good option.
Yeah. I don't know if you've seen the videos of those events. They open the gates, and there's people running into the store. Yeah. And you see a lineup around the block, around the store. It's crazy.
It's like Target on Black Friday.
Probably. Matt, have you been to one of those sales?
I haven't.
Black Friday sales?
There's a store halfway between us, Chris.
Yeah, I know.
Up in Bellingham. And I've thought about going, but I think if I went, I have to figure out how I got anything home without somebody knowing.
I'm just picturing Matt and I running for something and Matt just throwing me aside.
You'd outrun me after about 10 steps.
Yeah, I guess it's that too. the reason I mentioned Home Depot is that I think the Rigid bandsaws, it's got a pretty good reputation.
Yeah, didn't Fine Woodworking have that in one of their best value?
I think Michael Fortune even has one. I've seen them on sale.
That right there is impressive.
Yeah, that says a lot about
Michael Fortune's going.
He likes it too.
Yeah, I have a friend who picked one up at Home Depot for $100. I think their list price is $400. I can't remember what was wrong with it that he got it for $100, but it's a pretty cheap way to get into a bandsaw. A good bandsaw at that.
Yeah. Again, Michael Fortune's got the reputation as the bandsaw guy, so if it has his recommendation, then you can stand behind that. So
that's good to know. The Home Depot is an hour north of us, but both of our parents live an hour north of us too. So it's along the way if I go to visit.
There you go.
Yeah. Go and buy the bandsaw, and then if your other half is unhappy with you, she can stay there with their parents.
There you go.
It'll work.
My problem is I get it on the way up there and then not want to spend any time with family. I want to get home and use it.
Right, right. Yeah.
I know how I goes.
And I guess the other option, too, depending on what you want the saw for, is to buy a good jigsaw. You can buy a jigsaw for about $200, I guess, a pretty good one. And I have both a big bandsaw and a jigsaw, and I use them both for curves. It depends. They're both capable of cutting curves in stock up to 2 inches thick or even thicker with the right blade.
Yeah.
The tool I reach for is dependent on how heavy that piece of wood is that I'm cutting.
What do you guys think of the new Festool jigsaw they just came out with?
Don't bother.
It's not available yet, but
Don't bother. Oh, well. Don't bother.
Don't listen to Matt.
Matt's anti-festival.
For the price of the festival jigsaw, you could probably get a bandsaw and a really, really good Bosch jigsaw.
No, you can't.
How much is the festival?
Did I just freeze again?
How much is the festival jigsaw?
It's $360 in Canada.
Okay, you can't get a bandsaw. You get the Bosch jigsaw for much less, and it's and the high end Bosch jigsaw, the one that's made in Switzerland, is fantastic.
I do have the Bosch, and I do like it.
I can't recommend against the Bosch jigsaw.
The thing about the jigsaw is, if you put crappy blades in a good jigsaw, you're going to get rough cuts. If you put good blades in a crappy jigsaw, you're going to get okay cuts.
You can get pretty good cuts, actually.
But if you have a good jigsaw with good blades, you can get some fantastic cuts. Mm-hmm. Really fantastic. And then if you have a spindle sander, like that rigid combo spindle sander, then you can really fare out your cuts really well. But the other thing you can do is you can make templates, right, with the jigsaw, and you can fare them out, make them nice. And then you can rough cut your lumber with your jigsaw, and then you can use your template on your router table to make things bueno.
Yeah.
Really, especially with like a spiral bit.
Yep.
You can get exact matches. You can do pattern routing basically, and be very, very happy.
I will say this: now I have two bandsaws, but since I got a bandsaw, I think the only thing I've ever used my jigsaw for now is to put one of those carbide blades in it to cut cast iron pipe.
Yeah.
or steel for something.
Yeah.
So that's all my jigsaw gets used for now, and that's even rarely. So.
Wow.
Bandsaw just kind of.
Yeah. Different.
Takes the place.
Different strokes. I wouldn't be without my jigsaw.
Yeah. Jigsaw. I can see where you
would use it a lot.
I have more blades for my jigsaw, so I can do tighter cuts with my jigsaw. I can do curves on much larger pieces that I don't want to try and horse through the bandsaw. So it's a pretty awesome tool. When I had a DeWalt jigsaw that I thought was pretty good, and it sucked. The blades kept popping out and really rattled all over the place. And I tried to fix the blade holding, and the way it held the blade was it didn't center the blade in the arm. It pushed it over to one side. I got the Bosch T handle, and it's just amazing.
Yeah.
Sorry, I mean T-blade.
T-blade.
Not T-handle.
T-shape.
The Festool blades are phenomenal, and they are usable in other bands, jigsaws too, by the way.
Yeah, so I might get Festool blades for my Bosch jigsaw.
Get the, good.
I got an argument once between a Festool user, before I was a Festool user, about whether the Bosch blades, which I thought were better, or whether the Festool blades were better, which he was in favor of. And this went back and forth over a forum for 2 or 3 days, and in the end we found out that Bosch makes the blades for Festool.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I figured. They might even
make
the
Bosch blades are excellent.
Does Bosch make the Tryon blades for Festool?
Because
they're heavier and thicker.
I'm not sure.
They're premium ones.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Those Tryon blades are sweet.
Yeah. Yeah, they are pretty nice. Some of the Bosch blades. Well, what got me hooked on the Bosch blades was this one blade which I was given, and I put in my Black & Decker jigsaw, this probably like a 30-year-old jigsaw, and I was cutting plywood with it, and I'd do my scrolling cut, and I'd get a clean cut on the bottom, clean cut on the top. Like, I just couldn't believe that I was getting clean cuts from this jigsaw in plywood with these little thin veneers, right?
Yeah.
So
was it the 308B or 304? What's that?
I think they got a really
ultra clean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I used one of those actually, and it gave me really, really clean cuts.
I think it's a 3078. I might even have. I don't have them anymore. They gave the jigsaw away, but yeah, they're. Don't underestimate the importance of a good blade.
Yeah.
And they're not that expensive. The The Bosch
tanks. No, they're not.
Not that expensive.
Yeah.
And when they
get
out,
expensive when you.
When they wear out, you cut them and you use them to make marking gauges.
Yeah. They get expensive when you buy the long blades. We have a question from Jeremy Morgan about spiral rotor bits. Any preferences?
Yeah, I replied to him. I like the Eagle America and the Whiteside machinery. Because they're carbide, and
solid carbide.
You can get them where on one side it's upcut and the other side it's downcut. So there's no tear out on either side.
I definitely recommend the Whiteside. I'm a big fan of Whiteside. And they're made in the U.S. Actually, they're made right here in North Carolina. So.
There you go. Either way, no matter which company you go with, I would recommend the solid carbide bit.
Absolutely.
Unless you're only doing a couple of holes with it and you can't justify the cost. Infinity Tools, another company that I've bought spirals from, and they've been good. I like them. And they have a 5-pack, which is quite affordable.
Mm-hmm. Eagle America makes a bunch of their router bits in Ohio, and they also have an imported line. I always buy the ones made in Ohio, and they're pretty dang good.
I have everything going for them except that they're made in Ohio.
Hmm? What'd you say?
Everything's good about that except the Ohio part.
Yeah.
As a former Michigan person, anything about Ohio I detest. So.
Yeah.
Worst state ever.
All righty. Well.
Okay. Just to throw that out there.
Yeah, less than a month to college football, by the way.
And I cannot be happier.
Ah, love it.
And the Infinity ones are solid micrograin carbide, which is pretty cool.
Hey, Adam asks, do you guys use jigsaws a lot? Surprised this discussion. I think I mentioned that for me. I don't hardly use mine at all anymore. But
yeah, I use mine a lot for cutting curves in any material that's too heavy or awkward to bring to the bandsaw, big slabs especially. I also use it to cut curves when I'm too lazy to change from my 1-inch bandsaw blade, which is always.
Yeah. Exactly.
And also just to cut firewood to length.
I use mine a lot more now that I have a good one. I had my DeWalt, I just avoided it, and I would find myself changing up the way I was going to build something because I wanted to avoid using that shitty tool.
Yeah,
and now that I have it, I'm like, I'll do whatever I want. I'll put that curve here or round that off or do whatever I want.
You sound a bit like Jay there. I wonder what Jay's going to do after he gets a bandsaw. He'll be doing curves everywhere. Curvy. Yeah.
I'm going to make wheels for a week.
There you go. Make a jig and cut circles.
Yeah.
I use mine only to cut patterns in quarter-inch plywood that I will use my router to actually make my cut.
Ah,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, in a case like that, when you make a pattern, then template route it. Are you cutting close to the line with the jigsaw or anything, or just router it all the way?
I've done both. I did a pocket hole blanket chest where I actually used the router to cut it out. But followed it up with the template and routed it. But I've got a template for some trash can bases that I used to build a lot of.
Oh.
And I just route the whole thing. Just hog it through with the router.
So you just do it in multiple depths?
Nope, multiple just passes. one sweet pass.
Okay.
A little barbaric there, but yeah.
If it works. Matt, you had a follow-up question on, do you prefer a top or bottom bearing for router bits?
Yeah.
Spirals, I think he's talking about.
Yeah, I just replied. I find that most of the router bits I buy are either profiles or just a bunch of spiral bits of various sizes. I don't actually care if like I never buy a bit to fit a specific data, like half or three quarters or whatever, because
with a metro computer,
most of the time my wood is never perfectly dimensioned like that. So they have them now where you can get a bit on the top and on the bottom, a bearing on the top or on the bottom. I don't have any of those yet, so I have some that are top bearing, some that are bottom bearing, and some that are no bearing.
They each have their benefits.
Yeah, I was going to say, they both have places for use.
Yeah, if you're going to put them in a table, you might want a bottom bearing or for a pattern. If you're going to use them in a handheld router, you might want a top bearing. And then usually when I cut my dados, I'll use a top bearing bit, and I have a sled that's two boards that I can put together. You guys have seen those things, right? Where you put the wood in the sled, push the other thing up, tighten the two knobs.
The exact width dado jig.
The exact width dado, yeah. And I like it because I can do dados that don't have to be perpendicular to the edge. Mm. I can do them at an angle if I want to do angled shelves or anything like that. So that's what I usually use. So,
Adam asked me, how thick of a slab can you cut with your jigsaw? And this is the blade I use here for scale. This is a 6-inch square, so it's a bit over 6 inches long overall, maybe 6.5 inches, and about 4 7/8 inch protrudes from the base, so it's got a 1-inch stroke. So I cut probably almost 4 3/4 inches. I haven't cut a slab that thick before, but if I had to, I might be able to with the jigsaw.
Mm-hmm.
I guess to answer this question, I have cut slabs up to 2 3/4 inch thick.
Does the saw move pretty slow through that material?
Depends if it's hardwood or softwood. It's fairly slow. Maybe five minutes to cut an 8-foot length of western maple.
Yeah. So I just kind of posted a funny video. I'll have to watch that in a minute.
Yeah. I'm not sure what that's about. I don't recognize that thumbnail there.
What's that?
I don't recognize the thumbnail of that video you posted, Scott.
Oh, Festool did a video contest earlier this year, and that was the one that won, I think. But it's pretty funny. It's just a guy doing crazy stuff with the Festool.
Oh, yeah, I might have seen that one. Yeah.
All right. Have you guys ever used a scroll saw?
Yep.
I haven't.
I've never used it. My mom gave it to me. She found it at a garage sale, and I've never used it.
Yeah, it's got its place.
Yeah, it's one of those tools, again, where a crappy scroll saw will do really crappy work.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I had. That's why I got rid of it. But I have used a really nice scroll saw, and it's a world of difference. It really is.
Now, people that do a lot of scroll saw work really like those
DeWalt's. The DeWalt's are good. They're Excalibur, Scott, maybe?
Yeah, the Excalibur's one, and then there's one that's an orange. It's an orange machine. I don't remember what the name is here.
Orange.
I've seen a lot of them.
Yeah. Well, I think the DeWalt's probably one of the best saws for the money, and then the Excaliburs get up to the $800 range pretty quick, and then, yeah, there's a company on top of them too. I can't remember what they're called.
That's a lot for a scroll saw, if you ask me.
It is, yeah.
But if that's all you're working with, then, you know.
Yeah. The nicer ones, the heads tilt instead of the table, which is...
Mm-hmm.
Tegner. That's the...
Tegner, yes, that's... Yeah.
That's the one.
What do those run?
They're pricey.
Yes.
Gee. My goodness.
So how did we get to talking about curve cutting tools from a straight design.
We're talking about why Jay doesn't like curves.
Okay, there you go.
Yeah. And so then we all spent a half an hour telling him, you need to incorporate curves, and here's the tools you can buy. Come on, Jay, go buy the tools and do curves. What's wrong with you, Jay?
I'll have a bandsaw tomorrow.
Excellent.
And I say, if you want to continue to do straight, you continue to go straight, and you don't worry about curves.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's worked in the past, so.
Yeah.
So, anything else you guys want to talk about tonight?
I'm just checking for more questions here. Yeah. Jeremy Morgan posted the link to
the monster
the Charles Aang Big Daddy. Have you guys seen this one?
The what?
Seven flute spiral bit.
This bit here. Look at my screen share.
I'm missing some messages. Oh wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
one and an eighth inch diameter, 2 inch cutting length.
Yeah.
Six flute spiral, 3/8 inch bearing. Flute. Yeah, 4.5 inches high.
Yeah. The nice thing about the big bits is they have so much mass, they cut very smoothly.
Yeah.
That bit just looks like it would eat you.
Yes.
It's like feed-me. Like,
it's basically feed a small me flesh. Spiral, it's a small spiral jointer head.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. That's what they use on those tunnel boring machines. A little bit smaller, though.
And it's only $135.
Actually, that seems cheap for what it is.
Yeah, it's not bad for that. It's cobalt, though. It's not carbide.
Okay.
Ooh, fancy.
That would explain that.
Yeah, that's why it's cheaper. So, Chris, who's next in the telephone game?
Tim Charles is Mr. At a Slice of Wood. Oh. And he's following if he didn't get a call to go out and put out a fire.
Gotcha. Okay. And then what else do you? What else are we going to cover next week, you think, guys?
I've got this.
Oh, next week I won't be here, by the way. Unless I. Yeah. Well, I might, but probably not. I'm going to be up in Cincinnati filming a DVD, so.
Ooh. Oh.
I'll be at Popwood headquarters.
Nice. Very okay.
Cool. Very hoity-toity. Chris, will you be here?
I will be here.
Okay.
I may not be here the following week, though, or I may.
Okay, that's fine. Jay, want to make sure you know that you're invited back to talk about the design that comes after you. If you want to join the hangout next week as well.
Appreciate it.
You're definitely welcome. So, guys, what do you think? Is it time to wrap it up?
I think so.
Okie dokie, then. Well, everybody, that was Wood Chat for August 7th. Oh, my video just cut out. Today we talked with Jay Bates from Jay's Custom Creations about his design and the telephone game design challenge experiment. You should head over to his website at jayscustomcreations.com. I was looking at it during the broadcast. It's pretty cool, especially the Trash to Treasure section. Next week, Tim Charles will be on A Slice of Wood with his design. And Scott won't be here because Scott doesn't love us very much. We do this every Wednesday at 7 p.m. What's that?
He's ditching us for fame.
Yes, yes. He doesn't want to hang with the peasants anymore.
You don't even know if the DVD is going to sell yet. Come on, guys. It's me on it. But you're going to take a look at that guy's on of it. Nah.
You're going to be the Justin. You're going to be the Mumford and Sons of woodworking. We do this every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, over at uppercutwoodworks.com/woodchat/chatroom. You can jump over there and sign in with your Twitter account to join in the conversation. But really, the conversation never ends. Anytime on Twitter, just put up a tweet with the hashtag woodchat. And whether it's a question or a project that you want to show off or a design question that you want some feedback on, one of the friendly wood chatters will certainly help you out. So, Chris, you want to say goodnight to everybody?
Sure. A conversation chair design that I'm working, that I'm developing, and if we have time next week, I'll run it by you guys and hopefully get some feedback. You can kind of see some of my thought process on my blog at Flair Woodworks. I'll be posting some pictures of that shortly as well, some of the sketches I've done, and hopefully we'll get a chance to talk about that next week. Until then, I am signing off.
Scott?
And I'm Scott Meek again. And one thing I do want to share is next Wednesday is the end of the contest that I'm running. Every plane order until the 15th is a entry into the Wood Plane Weekend. So you can win a weekend with me making your own plane. Not the plane that you order for the contest, but a separate plane. And I'll teach you the ins and outs of wood body planes and all that good stuff. So I'll do that in your shop or mine.
And you get to be on the Popwood DVD. Maybe not. All right. Jay, you want to say goodnight to everyone?
Yeah, guys, thanks for having me on. Check out the website, jayscustomcreations.com. And if you guys want to see the design video for this particular table, youtube.com/jayscustomcreations. You can check it out there.
Cool. Thank you very much.
Thanks for being on, Jay.
Good night.
Night-night.